Nike is the biggest sportswear company in the world. A man's dream of better shoes over 50 years turned into a global giant worth over $100 billion. Today, we will go back to the earliest days of Nike to figure out how that magic happened and what ingredients worked for their success. The year is 1962 and Phil Knight had just graduated from Stanford. As any business graduate will tell you, becoming an entrepreneur is difficult if you don't have any good ideas. Phil was a distance runner back in university, and in one of his business classes, he had written a paper proposing the following idea. Phil had seen how Japanese cameras had replaced the dominant German cameras in the American market, and he wondered if Japanese shoes could do the same to Puma and Adidas, which were extremely popular in America. After writing that paper and graduating, Phil became obsessed with his idea about bringing Japanese shoes to the US market. Of course, he didn't actually own any Japanese running shoes, and a few he had seen were brought stateside by soldiers who had been stationed in Japan during their occupation after the Second World War. But this lack of exposure only reassured that he had stumbled upon a great opportunity and had to take advantage of it. He would have to establish contact with a Japanese company and negotiate with them to import their goods to America, both of which he had no experience with, but as is befitting of the man who created Nike, he went ahead and just did it. In November 1962, he flew over to Japan as a tourist and started exploring the city of Kobe. He stumbled upon a shoe store that caught his eye that belonged to a company called Onitsuka Tiger. And the shoes they made were of very high quality, so much so that Phil was determined to import them back home. He presented himself as an American shoe distributor and arranged a meeting with the company's founder. Phil made up a company name on the spot and offered to become the only distributor in America. A proposal which, probably to his surprise, the owner actually accepted. With nothing more than his confidence, Phil had become the exclusive distributor of Onitsuka Tiger in the USA. He received his first shipment of 12 pairs of shoes in 1963 and he started selling them out of the back of his car at every running track he could drive to. As he knew the strategy wasn't scalable, he went to the only person he knew who understood more about running shoes than he did, his former coach at the University of Oregon, Bill Bauer. Bill was one of the most famous coaches in America at that time. He had trained multiple Olympic athletes. He liked the Tiger shoes so much that he wanted to partner up. Thus, in January 1964, Bill and Phil incorporated Blue Ribbon Sports, each investing $500 into it. They spent all that money on their first order, which at $3.33 a pair amounted to 300 pairs of shoes. The shipment came through in April 1964 and thanks to Bill's connection, it was sold out by July. In their first year, BRS sold $800,000 worth of shoes and with that money, Phil started hiring salesmen for his company. In 1965, their revenue had increased to $20,000. Soon they opened their very own store. Phil was handling the business side of the operations while actual innovation was coming from Bill. He was the one who single-handedly brought jogging to America. In 1966, he wrote a book about it and sold over 1 million copies. And of course, his company was among the first to start marketing the Tiger shoes. With every new shipment from Onitsuka, he would open a few shoes to see how they were made and he'd always try to improve them. For example, adding to the cushion or using more lightweight materials. He'd constantly send his notes to Japan requesting changes. It was one of Bill's designs that catapulted them into the mainstream. The Cortez, as he called it, became one of the best-selling shoes in 1968. Thanks to the 1968 Olympics held in Mexico, Cortez VRS sold 300,000 worth of shoes in 1969. But they had a big problem. The Cortez was so successful that they couldn't keep up with the demand. Every new shipment they received sold out faster than the one before. But Onitsuka kept sending them at the same glacial pace. What Onitsuka were actually doing was satisfying their local demand in Japan first and then sending whatever was left to America. Phil and Bill knew that to expand, they would have to evolve beyond being just a simple distributor. Then they realized they held all the cards. As soon as their contract with Onitsuka expired, they were free to start making it for themselves. Luckily for them, their contract would end in 1972, just before the Olympics, in Munich, and Phil had plenty of time to prepare for his big move in 1971. He started working on the branding. His first employees suggested calling the brand Nike after the Greek goddess of victory. Then for the logo, he went to a nearby university and snatched the first graphic design student he could find and told her to make him a logo for the impressive sum of $35. And his branding now complete, Phil was ready for Olympics. This time, instead of locking himself into exclusive agreements, Phil established a network of subcontractors across Japan. With production under his control, Phil could finally spread his wings. Exactly when Phil started importing shoes from his Japanese contractor, and yes, he started before his contract could even expire in 1971. From then on, the story of Nike became one of growth. They became the largest sportswear company in America in 1989 on the back of brilliant marketing like Just Do It campaign and by signing rookie athletes that would eventually become famous across the world. The ascent of Nike is a story every bit as interesting as the early days of Phil Knight. Hey guys, if you like the video, do hit the like button and share and subscribe for more interesting videos.